Tame Impala releasing their own record, their debut on Friday, called Inner Speaker. And we were lucky enough to have a chat with Kevin and Jay from Tame Impala a bit earlier on today. This is the chat we had with them. We're joined by Kevin and Jay from Tame Impala. Thanks so much for joining us on the program today, guys.
Thanks for having us.
You played a gig, well, both of you, as Pond last night at the Workers Club, which, Jay, I understand it's a bit of a baby of yours, that project. And Kevin, you've just recently become involved.
Yeah, I'm the hired gun.
I used to play drums, even though I wrote the songs with Nick, purely out of the fact, purely because no one else could play drums. And I, one day, I was just like, stuff this. I'm well bored of playing drums in both of my bands. I'm going to play guitar and a show pony
and then rock, yeah, we pig.
Rock pig, we didn't even play drums.
And how'd the show go last night?
Yeah, it was good. I can never tell with Pond if it's really good or really shit, but like everyone in the crowd really liked it. So
for those who haven't heard of Pond's music before, can you describe where you're going with it?
Really ambitious pop music, a la ELO or the Beatles or what, Glowy or something, but played by fiends really crappily and like passionately.
Glam, funk, prog, epiphany pop, ballads.
It's all those things I said before filtered through like kind of some kind of royal truck sort of like, sort of trashy aesthetic, I guess. Yeah, what we came up with when we try to come up with stuff is naturally going to be different to Tame Impala because that's Kevin's songwriting kind of band. So yeah, we didn't even think about that. That was just what we came up with. Yeah.
And a new album finally has come out on Friday. You guys pretty excited about that?
Yeah, just relieved that I can hold it in my hands like a finished product. And it's worked out all right. You know, so many times in the making of it, I was like, oh no, this is just not gonna happen. Or you know, like you always have doubts, and with everything, like the sound of it, the look of it, you know, artwork and stuff.
But did you feel a bit of pressure with your first release?
You know, when we were recording it, I didn't really feel much pressure at all, other than like the desire to make an album that was as good as this guy's album, you know, another one of my friend's albums or something like that, you know.
It sounds really lame, but like we find it pretty hard not to get better with each album any of us do, and like, and songwriting each time, you know, like because we're not like 40-year-old kind of like, you know, like Warren Zevon type grizzled songwriting characters. We're like young guys who are still learning how to write songs. Yeah, that's old for me, man.
It's still like we're 27 or something.
Yeah, I said that. Yeah, I said something like that the other day. I was like, blah, 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 26 or something. And Jamie from the Suns, hey, I'm 26. But no, you know what I mean. Like we haven't been doing it forever. So like, I would like to think that each thing we do gets better because we're better at doing it.
Sure.
Didn't mean to diss anyone then.
We kind of rebound off each other creatively as well. It's like a competition, but we're always sussing out what everyone else is doing, and so we definitely that's definitely a cause for our like growth as songwriters or musicians or whatever. Definitely. Because no one wants to be left behind. If the other band is moving on to like synthesizers, the other one feels like, hey, what? You know, so yeah.
I want to play with synthesizers.
So yeah.
A lot of friendly competition then happening.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Definitely.
Psychedelic pop sounds there from Tame Impala, the new album Inner Speaker, out now on Modular, and the track Why Won't You Make Up Your Mind. Right before that, Lauren and my chat with two members, Kevin and Jay, from Tame Impala earlier today. We also were speaking to them a little bit about their intentions for the new album, moving from the sort of slightly lo-fi recordings of the early EP to the latest record, which is more highly produced.
I was really eager to make some music where I actually knew people were going to hear it. You know, the EP was not even really an EP, which is five songs that we selected from a whole bunch of demos. And so it was kind of like, it was definitely a surprise to like suddenly get these bedroom recordings and then just ship them off to, you know, all around the world. It was kind of like, oh, well, you know, this, it wasn't really designed for that. And so it was nice to be able to like craft songs.
It's good having a bunch of songs as well out that aren't like, don't sound like sort of 70s scuzzy rock as well. Like it's good having a
apparently
bunch of songs.
Apparently they do, apparently.
No. Oh, yeah, the guy I've interviewed before. But yeah, we reckon the album's like, although it's you know, guitar and drums and whatnot, we tried to put a lot of electronic emphasis on a lot of the playing and the parts in the song.
Do you think David Friedman, who you called in to mix the records, had helped you achieve that sound you're after?
Oh yeah, definitely. I had a lot of trouble mixing the album myself. I was on my high horse about doing it myself, and I couldn't get the explosions, the kind of punch that he gets. You know, I didn't have the right equipment or anywhere near the knowledge of sound wizardry that he possesses.
How did you come about working with him? He's worked with some pretty amazing people like the Flaming Lips and MGMT. Just give him a call one day.
I don't know how that whole thing turned up. We had all these theories about how he suddenly just called up the record label one day. You know, like we gave the EP to Wayne Coyne at Summersonic in Japan. And we thought maybe that's what it might have been, what it was. And then we thought maybe the MGMT guys gave it to him. But I think it actually was just that.
We gave Wayne Coyne all out. We gave him all the Pond albums.
Joe gave him all the Pond albums as well.
Embarrassing.
But yeah, I'm not sure how that came about, but he suddenly popped up and it was kind of like, yeah, it seemed like a real, like a godsend that he just suddenly appeared. And then they shipped me over there for 2 weeks.
He's really the only guy in the world that, like, modern producer type fellow who we really, really, really like.
What is it you like about the sound he can get so much?
It's just a really unconventional way of working. He doesn't care about conventions of, like, what should and shouldn't be coming out of the speakers. You know, like, what he actually likes is the most, like, blasting, speaker-destroying sound. Like, you know, the first mixes he did of it, I was like, dude, is there something wrong with the speakers?
he has no... I think what I got from Kevin was that he had no comprehension of having to make things sound good for radio. Or, like, they do, but, like, you know, making them easy listening.
Dave is the guy who knows that there are people like us in the world who are fiends for, like...
sonic demolition.
Yeah, yeah, you know, really, really blisteringly crunching sounds that, you know, most studio engineers won't allow musicians to get, but he's like the yes man of all that kind of stuff. So like you can just say, dude, turn the synth up louder than what is, you know, comprehensible, and he'll go, yeah, sure, Kevin. Zzz.